So it's Juho Väpseläinen. Yeah, I know you don't can't pronounce it, but anyway, so I'm like half Liverpool, half Snowen, because I live in the north, yeah, you know. And I guess that means that I do other things than just develop. I write books and do slides and little consulting training. So here we go. So this is actually like React Tabular. I will just skip to that topic and you'll get what it is. So today's agenda, I will describe how it evolved, because often when you see a component or a library, you just see what you see. You don't see how it became what it is. So instead, I'm going to tell you how what you are going to see became to be. I will discuss a couple of lessons I've learned during this process, because of course when you do something, you screw things up, yeah, and when you make screw-ups, then you kind of know to avoid them. So maybe you can avoid some of what I have done. So then I discuss a tool known as Lerna, and Lerna is something you can use to manage monorepos. Finally, I have a little bonus. So I have a couple of API patterns which I've noticed that are useful for developing React and in general. So this was, yeah, it worked. So this is actually a little demonstration my user Artem Sapegin set up. So he found the component and he was like, this is like the greatest React table component ever. And they started using it in their component. And he made a little demonstration for me. So he does a couple of things I don't even do in my own demonstration. So it's really cool. So you see like basic features like sorting and all that. Yeah, there's the sorting, I mean, tracking rows, and it has tree functionality. But all in all, it's quite full-featured. Yeah, but I guess I'll move forward. Then I have this, there's this guy, Tim Dorr, maybe someone has heard of him, and he said that this is like the best table component out there. So I get like a lot of excitement from users, so I have done something right. Starting points. It was well over a year ago. I had this little CRM project, because you know CRMs are so fun to code, so I needed a little table for it. And I looked at the React implementations and they didn't look that hot. So I was like, let's do it better. And that's where it started. And it's like the programmer instinct is to do something on your own when the existing options don't look that well, that good, but I don't know if it's a good thing, it's a bad thing. It's a good thing because then you get nice components, all that, but it's a bad thing because it's a time suck, so you will lose a lot of time doing something that kind of feels that should be easy but isn't. I started by pushing logic to a column definition. So I have this like columns will be named like this, and it should contain this data, and it should be formatted this and that. So that was like the fundamental starting point. I started like most guys, they start from single package. So let's throw all the functionality in single package and that's it. Yeah, first commit, it was January last year. So it has been going on a while. Public release 3 days later. So yeah, now I have some code, let's push it. So 0.20. You can see the basic design here. So this is like data in, I mean, it's just the table data. So you have like an array of objects. Any table library in the world takes this. Nothing special. But this is the more interesting part. So you have the column definition. So you can see that you can remap a certain property to like the first column, and then we pick up. We have like this header and this format and this editor. So this is like extension points for me. And I can also manipulate the cell formatting. So this was like the first question, an API. It doesn't look that pretty when I look at it now, but you have to start from somewhere. I also had this table definition, so it's not enough to have like data and columns, but also you have to push it to React somehow. So then you need this React part. Again, it's not the perfect design, because I have far better design at the moment, but you have to start from somewhere. 0.30, so I get like more and more ideas, and let's do more work. I noticed that I have some functionality that should not belong to this package, So I decided to push it elsewhere. So I get this pagination component outside of table component, which is kind of fun. It also gave me a chance to experiment with React context and React context based design. So I don't have to screw my table project because I can do the screw elsewhere. Yeah, and when it comes to the pagination bit, I noticed that there's some logic that could go to a package of its own. So I start getting these packages. The cell interface I had in place, it started to become powerful. You get like search, sort, inline editing. And here's more about the interface. So, yeah, there's like formatter, and you get the data and then you format it. You can return React component, whatever, from it. It actually exists in the current design, but it's more powerful. 0.40. So now I realized that let's do some event work so that we can actually control the header. So you start getting these basic concepts. But it was bad design, not flexible enough. So here you can see how not to do it. So you have like header and you have like some handlers, and yeah, it works, but it's not nice. 0.50. I started getting noticed. So I get like first guy is like, hey, here's a peer for you. And then I start improving documentation because I get interest. And then, of course, because React is React, the API has changed and I have to spend the time fixing my project. And I understand that maybe it's good to test your code. So I start writing tests. So because it's not fun to kind of break things all the time. I start understanding that maybe sorting can be like more flexible. So let's write some algorithms. So, and we get feature known as highlighting. So you have like search results. It's just boring to show that what matched. Instead, it's better to show that this exact bit of this and that row matched. So I got this from, it was some Disney guy that drew me up here, and now we have that feature. I understood that it's not that cool to kind of write a lot of utility functions yourself. So let's use Lodash. So now, at this stage, we get this external dependency to make our work a little easier. Of course, it ties the project to Lodash, but it's a much more cost. 0.60. I start finding these patches everywhere, so I'm thinking that let's put a couple of patches to my project. So I hooked up this BitHound. BitHound gives insight to code quality. So I get this listing, and from that listing, I can see that piece of code sucks, so let's rewrite it and so on. So it's just insight for me about my code, because it's very hard to be objective about your own work. And I set up this dependency thing. It's just none at the moment because there are no direct dependencies at the moment. Of course, there's a Lodash, but it's kind of hidden. Highlighting interface, it became better and better as we get to use code, we understand what's needed better. 0.70. So now we are getting like more and more contributors. So 6 contributors by now. And again, I find these little buttons. So I attach Skitter, which is like chat. So you can, if you have like something, you want to say something to me. So you show up at the chat, you say the thing, I say something back. And I found Travis. So I get continuous integration so that I get higher quality contributions, because it's not fun to fix someone's work. Yeah, but we get some functionality like custom props per each row. And we get support for editing complex objects. So every object is not like flat fields. There might be actually fields inside fields. So it's fun to support. 0.80. And yeah, maybe performance is a cool thing too. So let's set those row keys. So it was like, yeah, why didn't I figure out this earlier? But it happens. But again, tooling changes. Even I kind of contribute to React fatigue because I do some tooling. But yeah, that's the way it goes. I understood that Jest is not that fun. So I changed my test setup from Jest to Karma and Mocha based setup, which at the time it was good move because Karma and Mocha were so much better. 0.90. I simplified my development flow, so it's easier to get contributions. I might change the flow at some point again, but now I'm just in single master model. I guess, of course, I do feature branches, but it's just a value of simple. I had this huge readme, and when user shows up, it's really, really boring to like walk through all of that information. So I split it up. I started working on documentation a little bit more. 0.10, again, more people show up. And some naming changes happened because old names were not that great. Again, yeah, more naming, yeah. 0.110, better sorting. So instead of having sort by one column, let's do multiple. 0.120, I realized that maybe it's good idea to have change logs, because if you don't have change log, how anyone is going to figure out what has changed between releases? And it's like the first thing, because when you get this version bump, then you are like, what happened? Then you have to go like through git logs, and that's not fun. So you can do this fan service and write a little bit, describe what has happened so people can actually use your work. Lodash went to 4.0 because, you know, it just evolves, and we get 5.0 very soon, I think in a month or something like that. 0.13, again, enhanced functionality. So now we can do like multiple search filters. 0.40, and I realized that maybe it's a good idea to like force people to set that row key, because I don't want that they complain of performance, so let's force that. There were a couple of heavy dependencies in the project, so I just refactored them out. We have this awesome word in Finnish, pääversiomuutospelko, that describes, it's like word for the fear of bumping the major version, because the 1.0 is the scary one. So I think a lot of developers get this, so they have like 0 point whatever forever. But the point of NPM is that once you believe that your work is good enough for the public, you should publish the 1.0. It's just a fear you have to get like over. So that's what that happened here. So 1.0, it was like this year, about a couple of months ago, but I did it. So the interesting thing about this release was that I managed to attract attention from an American company, because they are doing certain product where tables happen to be like really crucial, and for some reason they saw potential in my solution, and they wanted to pay for me to work on my own library. So it's like the dream of open source developer. But yeah, sometimes that happens. So I just rewrote everything and started kind of pushing it to direction they need. So everyone is. I also rewrote the documentation. So instead of having like random files here and there I have actually a documentation site that contains runnable examples. I understood that the core design is like solid, but it needs some like sharpening. You have to take these core concepts out of your library and really make them shine. So that's what I did. So you get the rows and column definition, React definition, but in higher level. I started using Lerna to manage the monorepo. So what actually happened quite fast is that instead of having one package, I had 8 packages. I use package readmes as a runnable documentation, because I'm really lazy and I don't want to write a lot of documentation, so I will just use the readmes. The nice benefit of this is that when you publish package, it should be up to date, and I don't have to write that separate documentation page describing what's going on. I understood that it's actually very, very cool to drive development using examples. So I have this documentation, and I have these little examples there. So I'm like prototyping, exploring the what the current API enables me to do. So basically, I wrote a lot of examples based on my client requirements. And from these examples, I started to understand that I might need this and that package. And then I started pushing the examples to actual packages, so they began readmes. So instead of having to like jump to package right away, it gave me a lighter way to end up with actual functionality. 2.00, so I broke something here. So now it's like 17 packages instead of 8. I discovered that there's like something that's like usable beyond tables, so there's React Edit component. It should go to a own repository of its own at some point when I have some time. But again, I found something more generic within the table, which is kind of cool. And we get like more and more helpers for specific tasks like drag and drop or search. I realized that based on client requirements, it made sense to write a little like a wrapper or this layer between me and the client. So I have to work less and the client has to work less. So I wrote React Apple Easy. That's quite powerful. It's not as powerful as the default version, but it's powerful enough for the client. And it saves a lot of time because I don't have to be hacking their code all the time. I just hack the layer. So it's just to get the basic ideas at this point. So you get the data definition as before. You get column definition. It has changed a little bit. So you have property mapping as before. You have header mapping, which accepts label and it accepts even some customization through little format interface. We have cell mapping and it contains something known as transforms. So transforms are functions that are applied to a cell before you eventually format them. So you can intercept. And this interception mechanism allows you to implement inline editing and features like that. It's quite powerful. Finally, you can format the cell contents. And to make life a little easier, it's actually possible to resolve complex fields because they are like, let's say you have a country like FI or like DE or something like that, or ES. So instead of showing the ES or the FI to the user, you want to show like Finland or Spain. So then you resolve it. That's why resolvers and all that exist. And that's like the really core idea of this library. React side has evolved, so instead of being something rigid you kind of work with, I have something flexible instead. So I have little context that accepts header and body, and you can inject your custom function right there. So you get a normal table out of this if you want. And you can add your custom rows or footers or headers, or you can have multiple bodies that get different data and multiple headers between bodies, and like you can do crazy things with it. 3.00, performance started becoming an issue. So I implemented a technique known as virtualization. Because the point is that you have like 10,000 rows, and it doesn't make a lot of sense to render 10,000 rows all the time. So instead, let's do a little viewport and render what's only visible in the viewport. So instead of rendering 10,000 items, you render only 10 or so. It has a couple of cool features, but we can discuss about those later. API, it's shifted a little bit. As it just happens, you realize that naming isn't right or something like that. React Apple or Easy became a little better because it got to a virtualization and something known as tray functionality, because it's actually a common concern for people that they want a table that displays tree data. So that's really a fun problem for a programmer to solve. So how do I fit tree data to a table? So I had to do that. And I noticed that there are like third parties, like Radium. And because Radium is what it is, it doesn't like follow the standard semantics of React or something like that. So I had to do hacks on my side so that it works. But you have to live with the ecosystem. And yeah, I made the mistake there. I mean, the new feature. So maybe it should have been like 3.10, but mistakes happen. 4.00. Yeah, I started breaking things again, so that's what I meant with the fear, because when you get to 1.00 and start breaking things, you start getting to big versions. And yeah, this was like client requirement, but I really needed to push the version to kind of stay compliant with Xamarin. And yeah, you get features like all the time. It's just that's the way it goes. 5.00, I realized that earlier, React Apple Easy maintained a copy of state, of the column state. So I understood that that's really bad thing because you get duplicate state and that leads to certain bugs. So let's change so that the user manages the state instead. And I removed state from the component and exposed a function that allows user to manage. And I started understanding that a lot of these release bumps are caused by React Apple Easy. So because it lives like different life, maybe it should go to a separate repository. And of course, because Tree is new, we get like the API lives still. So it, of course, it's like a little problematic, but yeah, it was a good chance to make some changes to Tree API. 6.00. I saw also, because when I look at an API, I start seeing these inconsistencies sometimes. So in 6.00, I fixed some of these, or actually most. And yeah, I moved back to test. I mean, I had like testing setup, and it started feeling really slow and annoying to use. And in the meantime, test had evolved, so it had gained like incremental running when you run it in batch mode and all that. So it's like shiny and new. So let's move to test, and I'm really happy with test at the moment. And yeah, you get new functionality as always. But I watched the first release because I forgot to increase my peer dependency ranges because I didn't realize that Learner doesn't do that. So maybe it would be nice to have a kind of pre-published flow so you can test packages before publishing them. And yeah, always those fixes. 30 contributors by now. So it's like getting more and more popular that way. But as a downside, you get also support requests. So people, because they start using and they don't understand, then they ask questions and you have to answer. So that's like the downside of doing all this. So more serious. Yeah, bug fixes, features. I think I broke something because it's like bump. And drag and drop for 3 rows. So you can move these rows up and down. And yeah, now I pushed even more state out of easy, so it's like insane. And there was this guy, I don't know his real name, but he's known as Gitoni. So thanks Gitoni. So we post this selection functionality to select tabular library. So you get like logic in one place because the selection logic, it has nothing to do with tables. And there are like a couple of other bits like this that could be like pushed to own packages. So it would actually mean that people could like pick up the logic and use it in with their tables and so on. What next? Yeah, as I said, logic has to be moved elsewhere because it has not a lot to do with tables. And it was like a week or two ago, I realized that I have actually implemented the database engine. So it's like really, really crazy, but I have like a four-man database. And what I want is that I don't want to work too much, so let's let someone else do the work for me. So I have that community fixed up. And I see my role as a, like a shepherd. I don't want to work too much because I have other things to do. So, you know, I just like watch over peers. I get like feature, like people send me peers, I give them feedback, they work on peers and everyone is. But of course, client is the king because, you know, you have to eat. So I work based on client demand and add features based on client need. There is some like, you could say there's always some technical debt in a project. I track code coverage, so I could kind of work on that. So increase coverage and decrease the places where bugs can hide. There are a couple of trajectories where the work can go, so it can grow steadily. Like it goes into maintenance mode at some point, so I do that separating, and that's it. It could go with supported model, so I get some income and everyone else features. So it's basically consulting model. Or it could become business. I could sell like a commercial version with support. It could become the React router of the, all the table libraries for React. I hope this doesn't happen because it will just suck time. So let's hope. What I've learned here, so I think it's quite fun to kind of explore your API through examples. So you write these little examples and kind of look at your library components from the user point of view. Because if you do that, you will end up with something that's actually fun to use. Instead of focusing on features and functionality, you need to look at things from the other side. Examples, they become packages, and examples become new readme. So the flow is simple. And of course, at some point, ideally not too late, you write some tests so you don't break things. And it would be really good idea to have acceptance tests against the examples, because if you change the API and forget to change the readme, everything breaks, or at least the example breaks, so that's not fun. Censored management sucks, so I mean it has to be done, but it's really boring. So now I just, when I get new features done, I write them, and it would be like nice to automate this. So some people do some extraction based on Git, so they get like initial dump, and then they edit it together. So that's like one way. So yeah, the ideal is like semi-automation. I do a little Zed hackery because everyone knows that you can use AUG and Zed to do absolutely anything. So I use Zed to mark the dates. This doesn't work if we get to next year, so you have to get release out this year, but otherwise it's good. Just about change logs, I saw this today. So you don't have to be boring and write with them with text. You can do images. So you could do like this marketing image, which you tweet to your followers, and they tweet it to their followers, and you get this marketing effect. So make a nice picture that describes this and that has changed. So please use my awesome tool or library component, whatever. So open source is not about just developing. It's also about marketing and pushing your ideas. Because if you don't push, nobody finds, and you won't get peers and support requests, and you won't like spend your time on something you don't want to spend. I mean, it just depends on what you want. So if you want popularity, you have to push. Personal relations. I think MonoRepo was really good because it's far better than having a monolith. It's just leads better design, at least in my case. So architecture is like far ahead of what it could be. I mean, if it was monolith, so it was amazing, at least from my point of view. I believe that instead of having like the world's longest feature like list, like 1,000 features, you should have principles. So it's enough to have a couple of basic solid core principles and live based on those principles, because the features will follow. It's like I believe that's the right way to design. So you need, like, the design is reducing all of the mass into something simple and understandable. So that's what you should do. I have to learn more about API deprecation. It's not fun to keep pumping the major version. I should give warnings to people and all that. API lessons. Instead of JavaScript, it would be kind of useful to use TypeScript or FlowTap or something like that, that gives more feedback to your users instead of failing silently or like crashing the application of the user. It's fun to do some less. So maybe you can kind of check types and all that. Of course, the bugs, they are always in parts you have not tested, so it might make sense to have like high code coverage. But even if you have high code coverage, that doesn't like guarantee anything, but it's still better than nothing. So coverage shows what to improve. Semver is very easy to mock up, so you can make huge mistakes like that. It's just amazing. It's just explained to like normal people. So you have major version. So yeah, now I broke something. So let's bump the major version or minor version. Yeah, now we have new feature. Let's push minor version or patch version. I fixed bugs. It's kind of simple, but not. Comver is a backwards compatible alternative to Semver. So it's like binary decision. Is this compatible or not? And then you figure out the version. Of course, the third option is like the most common in this world. So emoware. So you have like emotional version, major version, minor version. And that's because people, even though, I mean, nerds don't admit it, but they are like emotional beings. About Lerna, just a couple of points. So you use it to manage multiple packages within the same repository. So it's good tool and bad tool. It's bad that it's too rigid. And I think the mistake of Lerna is that they are not using Lerna to manage the Lerna repository itself. So if you write a tool for managing more repos, use the tool on the tool repository itself, so you get better design. So it has a couple of commands, like bootstrap. So it will install all the dependencies of all the packages. Publish, so you can publish new versions, of course. Instead of having to go through all of the packages, it just pushes all of them out. Lerna run, so you might want to run a specific command for each package. So that's what it does. It has two versioning modes, fixed like Babel style or independent, so the packages live on their own. I wish there was a hybrid mode. So what I would like to see is that you could have like both in the same repository. So you could have like stable packages that are like fixed, and then you could have like have these development packages that are independent. Because I think it's good to have like the packages in 0. Something for a while before you have like the ABS like really solid. So it will make my life a lot easier. But this is still like at idea stage, and someone needs to do it. But I hope it happens someday. Good things. You avoid configuration overhead. You don't have to figure out how to do webpack configuration for each package. You can do it once and forget about it. And instead of having a lot of repositories to maintain, you have like single repository to maintain. Easier to auto. So when it's easy to auto packages, of course you write a lot of packages. Because there's like minimal pain, so there's like no decision to make. You just make the package. You get decoupled design. And I think that's a really good thing. And it actually might work for applications. Interesting thing about decoupling is that, yeah, well, I have table library for React. But of course, the logic is it's pure JavaScript. So it's going to work with Angular or Ember or Vue or the next hot thing that we get next year. I can write integration tests against the packages. So I can have like multiple packages and I can see how they work together. So that's cool. Add things. There's still like lack of understanding, and the tooling is not that stable, but it's like the idea is right, but the tooling is still, it's not there. Like, it's like mostly there, but not quite. The repositories can become huge, and if you make mistakes, like you push like binaries to Git, it's going to get like huge, big blob, and it's nobody likes that. There's a little bug in NPM, so NPM CD and makes a little, there's like coding mistake, they have not fixed it yet, so you have to hack around to get the readmes update. But of course, because it's more exotic setup and people cannot write that bootstrap, so it maybe it's hard to contribute, I don't know. But it feels like it could kind of feel like scary to some people. Ugly things. But now you have like single issue tracker and you have tons of packages. Maybe you end up like Webpack that you have like 600 issues open, so maybe that's not that great. Automated releases, no, not yet. It might be in the future, but not yet. I would like to see this because, again, it just takes away work. JSON management rougher than it should be. So, again, maybe tooling is needed. Let's say you have this private monorepo and you want to hire a contractor, but you don't trust the contractor enough to work on the whole code base. So how do you do that? So it's like, I don't know. So you have like this tiny package you want to kind of push outside. So how do you do that without exposing all everything? So this is like unsolved problem. Git lock, because you get all of those commits in single, it can become large. A couple of API patterns and then we'll wrap up, we get a couple of questions and next speaker. So React component wrapping, yeah, common pattern, so you pass children and do something with that. So I use this to make my API more flexible. So instead of emitting table, you can emit divs or something crazy. So you could like do a like list view or pretty much anything within certain limitations. Query pattern. So if you know something about object-oriented programming, the op guys, they like to inherit. So the functional guys, they like to query. So you can do this like similar idea. So you have like initialization phase and you get like a thinger to use and then you apply the thinger. And this is like very powerful and it's composable. So you can compose the current functions, as you can see in the next slide. So I have this I borrowed the compose from Redux, but you could use pretty much anything. But all of these accept rows, so you get this nice composition going on. So you get the data flow architecture. And actually this code, it has nothing to do with React Tabular, but it just happens to work with it. So that's like, that's cool. I wrote a couple of books. There's like one on Webpack, one on React. Yeah, I know they need updates, but that's like after I get less busy and you get updates. You can read them free online. There are also like 40 interviews of Dan and all, like famous guys, you know. And there's Twitter and enough advertisement. Yeah. So I made in Finland, so you know that little country up there somewhere. And thanks to Sapekin and Alec. Yep. So if you have questions, I will try to answer. Or you can, if you have, we can talk later on. Also. Yeah, it could be because I mean it's a little problematic when you have like 0.515 and then you get 0.20. So what happened in between? So and because people don't write those change logs, it's a little painful.
So I mean if you look at browser, if I never had 0.something, it's like version like 14 or 13.
Yeah. But it's just that versioning is hard. And I think Comware is like good step to better direction because Comware is simpler and it's still compatible. So, yeah.
You mentioned some tool for documentation. What the benefits of using this?
I author my documentation using Markdown, so it's like that simple for me. I write Markdown, I write little code, and then I get interactive example out of that code. Maybe I will show the site, so you see.
But you mentioned some tool for...
Yeah, I can show the tool. Yeah. There's like something... Yeah, sorry, it's not my computer, so I don't really do that well with... Like, and they messed up the layout, great. Yep, it's fine. Yeah. It's actually easier if I show the site, so I can find. So let's say you are like a user that wants help. So, open chat, ask question. That easy. The tool, I will show, here's the GitHub, so you can visit later, find the code. I think I'll give a little example. I just have to figure out, flashy thing, so. This is like super simple example, but. It matches Ian out of Brian. Super simple. And this it comes from Markdown. And the tool is catalog. So I don't actually like catalog, but I use it because it's good enough. I have like better ideas of how you should do it, but it's like when I have some time I'll do it the right way. The main issue with catalog is that you get this 2 to 3 megabyte bundle. And it's single page application, and that's absolutely not how to do it. But it's worth checking out. Yep.
You talked about having principles over features.
Yeah.
Could you write more? Could you put an example?
Yeah. I mean, it's just those three things. I mean, the data definition, column definition, and the React part. So, something like transforms. The idea of what is a transform is like this. Little design pattern I discovered. So I have these little patterns and currying. I use very consistently currying across my APIs. So that what I want is that people don't have to spend too much time with the documentation. They can just get the thing done. I also have this principle that because I don't like to do support work that much, I just want to push all of the work to users. So it's better for me to do something flexible instead of all the features.
Mentioned that open source is not only developing but marketing also?
Yes, I believe it's like more and more because there are so many open source projects, so many developers, and they're like great projects nobody knows anything about. And that's because these guys have like no idea how to get their like work, like visible. They might even not want that, but sometimes you might actually need to like put the marketing hat on and figure out how can I make it easier for people to find my work and use it.
And can you give us some examples of what you did with Reactabular to push the delivery off?
Yeah, so I chose anti-tactic because I don't want it becomes popular. So I did nothing.
And the last one.
Yeah.
Do you think there's a risk of, if you have lots of separate packages, do you think there's a risk that each package is then less popular rather than having one big thing?
I actually do something against that. So I have this like Reactabular mm-hmm. package that actually aggregates all of the small packages. So instead of having to get like 10 packages to get anything done, you get that one package and you get like benefits of the both worlds.
Right.
Yep.
You talked about sponsor invitation from company.
Yep.
How did it work? I mean, because it's open source code, but still your company paying.
Yes. Yes. So they understand the value. I mean, they came to me and they told that, yeah, we like your table component. We will pay for you to kind of work on it. And so far it has worked nicely. So we have this little business relationship going on. Both get something out of it. And actually it's in the company's interest that the table gets used. I mean, we get more and more users like every day. And they get better and better library because of that. So instead of keeping like, the alternative would be like to develop like table of their own. But then the problem is that it's something for them to maintain and it costs money. So
and you're free to, I mean, pay any voice in decision or you're free to develop the library?
Yeah, I can pretty much go to any direction I like as long as like I keep the client happy enough. But I prioritize what client might have like in mind. So he wants a feature, of course I add the feature.